Okay, this is number one. Number two, I think we have to decrease the screen time. So maybe we can take maybe two breaks during our class. Each break maybe 5 to 10 minutes to go away from the screen. So we are interested to decrease the screen time. Okay. I think that's all. If you don't mind, we can start our presentation. I think we have now 115. So our topic today is how to examine the respiratory system. How to examine the respiratory system. Okay. Our learning objective by the end of this session or this class, everyone should revise his knowledge about the anatomy and physiology of the lung and the respiratory system. Then you have to demonstrate how to perform a professional physical examination of the respiratory system. And lastly, how to differentiate between the normal and the abnormal physical signs. The normal and the abnormal physical signs. Those are our learning objective today. Okay. So I'm sure now you are aware what is the anatomy of the respiratory system. As you know, the respiratory system extends from the nose down to the alveoli. From the nose down to the alveoli. This includes not only the air conducting passage and the bronchial tree, but also the vasculature of the respiratory system. So keep in mind those basic anatomical data. Then the main function of the respiratory system is the gas exchange. Okay, that involves the transfer of the oxygen and carbon dioxide between the air and the blood. That's vasculature. So the exchange between the oxygen and the carbon dioxide, this is the main function of the respiratory system. The respiratory system is mostly subdivided into two parts, the upper respiratory tract and lower respiratory tract. The upper respiratory tract consists of the nose, the pharynx, and I'm sure you know pharynx is subdivided into nasopharynx and oropharynx and hypopharynx. And then the adenoids, tonsils, epiglottis, larynx, and trachea. All those components are the upper respiratory tract. For the lower respiratory tract consists of the bronchi, main right and left main bronchus, and the bronchioles. The bronchi is mostly subdivided into many, many bronchioles, and then the alveolar ducts, and then the alveoli. Those are the components of the lower respiratory tract. Except for the right and the left main bronchus, all of the lower respiratory tract are included within the lungs, This is a anatomy. And as you know, the right lung is subdivided into three main lobes, upper and middle and lower lobe, and the left lung subdivided into only two lobes. Okay. The most important anatomical structure of the chest wall, you have to keep in mind, the chest wall is composed of ribs and the pleura and the intercostal muscles and the other muscles of respirations. All are constituents of the chest wall. Please keep in mind those structures when we are going to talk about chest wall expansion. After a while, we are going to assess the chest wall expansion. At that moment, please remember what are the structures of the chest wall. The structure of chest wall is ribs, pleura, intercostal muscles, and the other muscles of respirations. Okay? This is very important. you have to remember also what are the nerve supply of the respiratory system. We have two nerve supplies, sympathetic and parasympathetic. Those are the. Then you have to know what are the surface anatomy, what are the surface anatomy of the pulmonary system. Those photos demonstrating the anterior aspect and the posterior aspect and the lateral aspect. As you know, this is the anterior aspect of the lung. The right lung is composed of three lobes. From the anterior aspect, you can assess and examine the upper and the middle lobe. Mostly, this is the anterior aspect. For the left lung, most of the anterior aspect, you can examine the upper lobe only. Very tiny part of the lower lobe can be assessed from the anterior aspect. But for the posterior aspect, you are mainly examining the lower lobe of both lungs. Okay, for the you can see this line is the fissure in the transverse fissure between the upper and the lower lobe. This line exactly. Doctor, yes,
we're not able to see your cursor.
You cannot see. Okay. Okay, forget the precursor. For the light lung of the posterior aspect, you can see the upper and lower lobe. The upper lobe is the green and the lower lobe is the violet. And you can see the fissure between the upper and the lower lobe. For this patient is raising his hand above his head. Okay? You can imagine the medial border of the scapula. The medial border of the scapula is exactly at the same line of the fissure between the upper and lower lobe from the posterior aspect. You can imagine like this. If you are examining the posterior aspect of the patient, okay, and you ask the patient to put his hands above his head, so you can imagine the medial border of the scapula at the same level. This is the fissure between the upper and lower lung. And don't forget that the chest or the respiratory system, we have anterior aspect and we have posterior aspect and we have lateral aspect. So keep in mind the chest is three aspects, anterior and posterior and the lateral aspect. Okay, again, this is very important to know the surface anatomy. You can see in this photo the tracheal tree or the bronchial tree, the Adam's apple or the larynx and the trachea, and then the bifurcation of the trachea and the main bronchus and the bronchial tree. As you can see, the trachea is mainly passing down through the neck, and the level of the tracheal bifurcation is exactly at the same level of the angle of Lewis. So keep in mind the angle of Lewis is at the same level of the tracheal bifurcation. And I'd like to ask one of the smart students. This is maybe I can ask Ahmed Ayham Khalid. Ayham Khalid, can I ask Ayham Khalid, what is the level of the tracheal bifurcation and what is the level of the angle of Lewy? I mean, at what level I'm talking about the the vertebral column or the thoracic vertebrae? At what level of the tracheal bifurcation in relation to the thoracic vertebrae? أيهم خالد؟ أيهم خالد؟
Hello.
How are you, أيهم؟
I'm doing good, alhamdulillah.
أيهم, can you tell me what is the level of the tracheal bifurcation in relation to the spine or the thoracic vertebrae?
Yes, maybe. Inferior portion.
No, I am
talking about the trachea.
The tracheal bifurcation. You know the tracheal bifurcation?
No.
The tracheal bifurcation, the trachea is going down and then bifurcated, subdivided into right and left main bronchus. Mostly, this is the level of the angle of Lewis, the sternal angle. Okay?
Fourth or fifth thoracic vertebra?
Fourth. Fourth, not fifth, fourth.
Fourth, okay.
Okay, thank you, Ayam. Thank you. Okay, so this is the surface anatomy of the tracheal or the bronchial tree. Keep in mind this surface anatomy and try to correlate to the clinical physical examination. Okay. And regarding the physiology of the respiration, as you know, the main function is ventilation. Ventilation means inspiration. This is inhaling the air. So the air will move into the lungs, and expiration, so the air will move out of the lung. So this is, you know, this diagram is simple diagram that demonstrate the respiratory unit, the alveoli and the adjacent capillary, and how the oxygen is coming in from the alveoli into the capillary respiratory vessels. Hello? Okay, so this is the main function of the respiratory system. And the air moves in and out of the lung because the intrathoracic pressure changes in relation to the pressure at the airway opening. Okay? So, as you know, contraction of the diaphragm and the intercostal muscle and the skeletal muscles increase the chest dimension. You know, the diaphragm normally will be like this. This is the relaxation, like dome of the diaphragm. So when the diaphragm will contract, it will be like this. So contraction of the diaphragm increase the dimension of the chest and decrease the intrathoracic pressure. Again, the relaxed diaphragm is like this, okay? And when contracted, it will be going down like this. So contraction of the diaphragm means increase in the chest dimension. Increase the chest dimension means decrease in the intrathoracic pressure. And as you know, the gas will flow from the area of high pressure, this is the atmosphere, to the area of the lower pressure, this is the lung, by contraction of the diaphragm and respiratory muscles. So ventilation and getting the oxygen in and getting the carbon dioxide out, this is the main function, physiological and the mechanical function of the respiratory system.
Doctor?
Yes.
At the previous slide, what is scalene muscle?
What is scalene muscle? Scalene muscles. Scalene muscle, this is one of the scalene, what is this scalene muscle? Okay, the skeletal muscle, this is one of the respiratory muscles. This is, I think, if you go back to the anatomy of the respiratory muscles, you can find out the origin and the insertion. Intercostal muscles, as you know, this is the intercostal muscles between the ribs and the skeletal muscles. This is one of the neck muscles, one of the neck muscles. This is one of the respiratory muscles. When contract, it increases the chest dimensions. Okay, so I think you can refresh your anatomy regarding the origin and the insertion of the right skeletal and left skeletal. What is the blood supply? What is the nerve supply? Skeletal muscle, one of the respiratory muscles. Is it clear?
Yes, thank you.
Okay, so I hope you can focus on this YouTube video. This is Oscar Station, how to okay, if you don't mind, we can consider this video as 10 minutes free time. Okay, so you can take your snacks, drink some, you know, coffee or tea, but at the same time you can watch this OSCE YouTube, how to perform respiratory physical examination, and please stay focusing and stay paying your attention. So after this tube, we can discuss how to perform respiratory examination. Okay? So you cannot see the video? Hello?
Yeah. Go on.
Can you see the
yeah.
YouTube video?
Yes, we can.
But someone told me they cannot see.
They actually can click the link.
So so how can we? Okay, let's do like this. So, Jonathan? Jonathan?
Yes, yes, you can hear me.
Jonathan, I'm not sure if that video is clear for everyone or not.
Oh, we have to kick ourselves.
So anyway, I will upload the PowerPoint presentation to the Microsoft team so everyone can get access to the group and later on he can watch the OSCE YouTube how to perform from the examination. Okay. Welcome back. I hope everyone is around. Assalamu alaikum.
Yes, Prof.
Okay. Now we are moving to how to perform a physical respiratory examination. The component of our examination is like this: first, general examination, and then systemic or focused or local examination to the chest, and then examination of other system. Okay, what does it mean, general examination? For general examination, the introduction to general examination is like this. For every clinical examination, whatever it is, lung or cardio or neuro or GIT, this is the WIIPPPPE. This is the introduction of any general examination. This very worldwide common nomenclature for the introduction of general clinical examination. W stands for washing hands. Stands for washing hands. This is the W. And I for you have to introduce yourself. You have to introduce yourself. So tell the patient what is your name, what is your title or position. And then the second I is you have to identify your patient. You have to confirm your patient identification, the name and the age, etc. So this is washing hand, introduce yourself, identify your patient, and then P is permission. Is the patient permission or the patient consent? You have to tell the patient what you are going to do, and you have to get the patient consent or permission. The second P is you have to ask your patient if he has any pain or not. Ask your patient if he has any pain or not. This is the second P. The third P is the patient privacy. You have to preserve and you have to keep the patient privacy. Don't examine the patient in open area or in a non-secured place. And then lastly, the position. The position, the preferred position for respiratory examination, the patient should lie supine in 45 degrees. This is the ideal position to do respiratory examination. And lastly, E is the exposure. You have to expose your patient from the umbilicus upward, So this is the standard introduction for general examination. Please do remember and memorize this introduction, WIIPPPE, and you have to remember what this abbreviation stands for. Okay, this is the most important, and you have to practice this in every clinical examination. Okay, and then you have to comment on the surrounding. You have to take the vitals. You have to have a general overview. You have to examine the head and the neck and extremities. Okay. So what does it mean, the surroundings? The surrounding. You have to comment on any surrounding monitoring items. If the patient have pulse oximeter, any monitoring ECG, okay? You have to comment on the monitoring items surrounding the patient. And then you have to comment on the treatment tools, any IV lines, any chest drain, any inhalers nearby the patient, any oxygen mask, okay? So you have to comment on those treatment tools. And lastly, the paraphernalia, any food jacks, any sputum port, any cigarette packs, any cigarette gum, okay? All those are very relevant and important comments you have to present to the examiner if you are going to do a standard professional physical examination. Don't forget to comment on the surrounding. I mean the relevant surrounding. If the patient have any, you know, wheelchair, any walking aids, all those are very important and relevant surrounding. You have to comment on. Okay, and then you have to take the vitals. Take the vitals. We have how many vitals we have? What are the vitals? What are the vitals you have to comment on? I'd like to ask Gobi. Where is Gobi? Can I hear from Gobi? Gobi is not around.
Yes, doctor.
Welcome, Gobi.
Yes, doctor.
What are the vitals you have to take for your patients?
The temperature, doctor, the BP, pulse rate.
What else?
Respiratory rate.
Excellent. What else?
Pulse rate, respiratory rate, BP, temperature.
Vein scoring.
Oxygen saturation.
No, not oxygen. Oxygen saturation is not vital. Is not vital sign.
Check their beam, pumps.
No. The scoring of beam. If the patient have beam, you have to specify the scoring of the beam. Okay. Thank you, Gobi. Okay, so we have five vitals. You have to comment on the temperature, the pulse, the blood pressure, and the respiratory rate. Okay, you have to take on your own, and if the patient have been, you have to score the being that the patient had. So for example, if the patient have high grade fever, you can suspect pneumonia. If the patient have low grade fever, you can suspect TB or suppurative lung disease or even lung cancer. So it is very important to assess the body temperature. And then you have to comment on the pulse rate, okay? Sometimes if the patient have collapsing pulse or water hammer pulse, this is most likely to be due to emphysema. If the patient have radioradial delay or unequal pulse in both hands, this is mostly due to thoracic inlet syndrome, means something obstructing the thoracic inlet in one side of the patient. And the blood pressure, you have to take it by yourself in your own, because blood pressure can be increased in a case of bronchial asthma, especially status asthmaticus or resistant asthma. Blood pressure can be decreased or lowered in cases of TB and hemoptysis. So very important to take the vitals again on your own, by yourself. Don't follow the medical records. Don't follow the nursing notes. You have to take it by your own. And as Gobi has mentioned right now, you have to take, you have to count the respiratory rate. You have to count the respiratory rate. Okay, after this, you have to present an overview for your patient. General appearance. Is the patient is fully conscious or semi-conscious or non-conscious? Is the patient is oriented and alert, cooperative, or distressed? So you have to comment on the general appearance of the patient. Then you have to comment on the body build. the body built to ablation? Is the patient is overweight or the patient is cachectic and underweight? So this is very important. You have to comment on the color of the patient. Is the patient is cyanosed or jaundiced or pale or anemic? So the color of the patient is very relevant clinically. Decubitus of the patient, the decubitus is the preferred position of the patient in the bed. Some patients, in some cases, they prefer certain position. For example, in fallot tetralogy, the patient position, the preferred patient position will be squatting position. So squatting position is the preferred decubitus if the patient have congenital fallot tetralogy. Okay, this is the decubitus. And the facial expression, if the patient is distressed or the patient is depressed, so the facial expression, as you know, for example, the common facial expression in thyrotoxicosis, is the exophthalmos. So exophthalmos is one of the specific facial expression. And then you have to comment on the mentality of the patient. Is the patient is oriented or not? Is the patient is alert or not? So this is the general overview of the patient before going to the next one. And do you have any comments or any questions before we are going to proceed? I think we can take some comments or questions before proceeding on.
Doctor?
Yes, please.
What is decubitus again?
Decubitus again. Okay, thank you for prefer the position. Some patients prefer specific position on lying on the bed. So some patients can prefer to lie on the right lateral side or left lateral side. Some patients prefer supine position. Some patients prefer prone position, some patients prefer sitting up position. So this is the decubitus. Is it clear?
Yes, doctor. Thank you.
Thank you for your questions. Any other questions, please?
Doctor, I have a question.
Yes,
when the patient is on oxygen, okay. Do we take it out when we're examining respiratory system or no. Do we leave it on?
No. Don't take it off. Leave it, but you have to comment on the oxygen, for example, oxygen pressure. The patient can take oxygen under 2 liters or 5 liters. So you have to comment if the patient is on oxygen and how many liters the patient is taking, but don't take it off. Is it clear?
Yes, doctor, thank you.
You have to move to the next step in examination. You have to examine the head and important before going to the chest examination, you have to examine the eye to check if the patient has any congenital fallot or not. You have to examine the fan, ask the patient to open his mouth, raise his tongue, look to the under surface of the fan. Is it pink or blue? So you have to comment on the central cyanosis. And then you have to comment on the tongue. Is it dry or not dry? So you can comment on the dehydration or hydration status. Then you have to examine the cervical lymph nodes. Some patients can have cervical lymph nodes due to tonsillitis, for example. due to pharyngitis, for example, due to lung cancer. So you have to examine the cervical. Then you have to comment on the neck veins. Is it congested or not? I mean the jugular vein or the carotid artery. And you have to differentiate between the jugular vein and the carotid artery. Jugular vein is congested, occludable, double wave, but the carotid artery, you cannot see, but you can feel the pulsation. Okay? It is not occludable, it is not occludable. And so you have to comment on the neck veins, means jugular vein, is it congested or not? And the carotid artery, is it you can feel or not? Don't forget to comment on the working elamizide, working elamizide. I'm not sure if you, is the camera is on or off. So you have to comment on the working elamizide. Working elamizide is, this is the nostril, the nasal opening. If the nasal opening is, moving in and out rapidly, this is the working elamizide in the cases of pneumonia, for example, and if the patient has respiratory distress. Then you have to comment on the physical signs of superior vena cava obstruction. If the patient has superior vena cava obstruction, you can notice the congestion of the neck veins, swelling of the face, puffiness of the eyelids. So those are the physical signs of superior vena cava obstruction. In some cases of lung cancer, you can see severe vena cava obstruction. Physical signs means congestion of the neck veins, swelling of the face, puffiness of the eyelids. This is the superior vena cava obstruction physical sign. And lastly, the ptosis of the eyelids and meiosis of the pupil. Those are physical signs of Horner syndrome. Horner syndrome, that means the patient has bronchoscopy. Bronchoscopy tumor is the tumor of the apex of the lung. Tumor of the apex of the lung will compress the sympathetic chain, and the patient will be present with ptosis and meiosis and anhidrosis. So those are the relevant clinical comments on head and neck examination in respiratory cases. Okay. So before proceeding on, do you have any questions or comments on head and neck examination? Okay. So after that, you have to examine the extremities. You have to examine the hands and the lower limbs. You have to examine the hands and lower limbs. The most important physical sign is like this. You have to comment on the clapping of fingers, clapping the tremors, edema of lower limb, and if the patient has finger cut. Okay, this is how to examine finger clapping. We ask the patient to do like this, okay, to comment on the finger clapping. This is what we call window test. And you have to know what is the pathogenesis of clapping, what is the pathology of clapping. Clapping mostly due to anoxemia, decrease in the oxygen, that lead to vasodilatation of the vasculature of the main vein, and proliferation of the soft tissue, increase in the capillary permeability, and increase in the anteroposterior diameter of the nerve. This is the pathogenesis of the clapping. And you have to know how to examine the clapping. You can do like this. You can ask the patient to raise his finger at the level of your eyes and looks tangentially to assess the main angle. Is it obliterated or not? and you can do the wind test as I said right now. This is the wind test. This is if the patient has clubbing or not. And you have to know what are the stages or what are the grades of clubbing. We have five stages. Stage one, this is the softening of the nail bed and the flexion. Stage two, obliteration of the angle of the nail bed. And stage three, increase in the anteroposterior diameter of the distal flanks. And stage four, drumstick appearance of the finger. And stage five, this is hypertrophic osteoarthropathy. And you can assess the osteoarthropathy at the distal end of the radius and ulna. Distal end of the radius and ulna, you can find a hypertrophy of the distal end of the radius. Those are the five stages or five grades of clubbing, and this is very significant physical sign in respiratory examination. And you have to keep in mind what are the respiratory causes of clubbing. Very, very wide range of pulmonary diseases can be presented with clubbing. So the differential diagnosis of clubbing is very important. Can be bronchiectasis, lung abscess, empyema, lung cancer, fibrosis. All those can be the differential diagnosis of clubbing. Okay, this is the general examination of the pulmonary or respiratory cases. Before going to the chest examination, you have to look to the other system. You have to examine the liver. Is the patient have enlarged liver or not? Organomegaly. Does the patient have any enlarged spleen? And you have to examine the abdomen for ascites, because some chronic pulmonary diseases can be presented with heart failure, So chronic lung diseases can be complicated with heart failure. That's what we call cor pulmonale. So cor pulmonale is a heart failure due to pulmonary disease, right-sided heart failure due to pulmonary disease. So if the patient is chronic pulmonary case and complicated with cor pulmonale, you have to rule out hepatomegaly, splenomegaly, and ascites. So you have to examine the abdomen to rule out physical signs of heart failure. That means no hepatomegaly, no splenomegaly, no ascites. This is the general examination before we are going to do systemic focused respiratory examination. Any comments or questions or proceeding on? Okay, so As you know, a systemic or focused local examination consists of four items: inspection, palpation, and percussion and auscultation. For inspection, you have to comment on the chest wall lesions or scar. You have to comment on the respiratory movement of the chest. Is the chest is moving freely and normally with respiration. You have to comment on the shape of the chest. You have to comment on the mediastinum. Mediastinum means you have to comment on the trachea and the apex of the heart. You have to comment on any abnormal pulsation you can see. And if there is any radiotherapy tattoos. Tattooing is the landmarks. If the patient has history of radiotherapy, you can see tattoos or landmarks of the radiation fields. So this is the main items of inspection of the chest or respiratory system. Okay, this is abnormal chest shapes. You can see in special cases. You can see the sternum protruded, or you can see scoliosis or kyphosis, and you can see cachexia. And this is the normal and the abnormal chest shape. So you can see the normal chest shape, where the transverse diameter is more than the anterolateral. But in the barrel shaped chest in chronic obstructive lung disease, the anteroposterior diameter is larger than the transverse diameter. You can see scoliosis, pectus crenatum, or pectus excavatum, or kyphosis. Those are the abnormal shapes of the chest. And you have to comment on the respiratory movement. The normal respiratory movement, you can see the chest rise up during inspiration and rise down, going down during expiration. This is the normal, but sometimes you can have abnormal respiratory movement, like paradoxical respiration or kinestoxic respiration or cosmal respiration. Those are the abnormal respiratory movement. This is for the inspection. Then for the palpation, you have to palpate the trachea. You have to do assessment of the chest wall expansion. You have to palpate the mediastinum, means the apex of the heart, and you have to comment on any abnormal pulses. At the same time, you have to comment on the tactile vocal pharyngitis. Does the patient have any wheeze or any chest tenderness? Those are the items of the chest palpation. Okay, you can see in these photos how to assess the chest wall expansion. The standard way to assess the chest wall expansion is to measure the chest circumference by using the tape. So ask the patient, you can keep your tape around the chest, whole circumference of the patient's chest, and ask the patient to take deep inspiration and then take deep expiration, and you have to calculate the circumference, and you have to subtract the circumference of the chest to take the difference between circumference in expiration and the expiration, and normally the difference is around 5 centimeters. This is the standard way. But the clinical bedside teaching is to use your hands, okay, to assess the chest expansion, okay, like these photos from the anterior and posterior aspect. Okay, I'd like to remind you, or I'd like to ask you, what are now we are doing assessment of the chest wall expansion. Okay? So may I ask anyone to tell me what are the components of the chest wall? As I said in the beginning of my presentation, what are the components of the chest wall? I'd like to ask. Rashid, can I ask Rashid, what are the components of the chest wall? Rashim. Rashim is not around. Rashim is not online.
Doctor, is it Rachel?
Come again.
Doctor, is it Rachel?
Yes.
Doctor, I didn't get your question.
What are the components of the chest wall? Did you get my questions? What are the components of the chest wall? We already discussed in the first slides of my presentation.
Doctor, is it ribs, sternum?
Yes.
Ribcage, sternum.
No, not sternum. This is the ribs and the intercostal muscles. Okay. And the pleura, the pleura. So the chest wall, chest walls components are the ribs and the intercostal muscles and the pleura. Okay. So we are going to assess the chest wall expansion, like these photos. So put your hand like this, okay? Put your hand like this, okay? And ask the patient to take deep breath. So you can find your hand moving outwards. Your hand moving outwards. So this is how to assess the chest wall expansion. Okay, so assessment of the chest wall expansion is important component of the palpation. Then you have to assess the trachea. Is it central or not? This is the first photo. Put your middle finger directly in the suprasternum notch, and you have to palpate the trachea. Should be central, okay? Then you have to ask the patient, put your hand over the chest wall, anterior and posterior, and ask the patient to say 99. To say 99. And then you can feel by your hand the vibration of the 99. This is the tactile vocal pharynx, tactile vocal pharynx. So normally you can feel the palpation or the vibration of the patient's 99. If the patient said 99, you can feel the vibration. If you going to put your hand as your palm of hand, or you can put your radial surface, radial aspect of the your hand. Okay, so the palpation, you have to palpate the trachea, you have to do tactile vocal. Perimeters, is it equal on both sides only? Then you have to do percussion, and I'd like to ask you to watch this video. Okay. Just a minute. Okay, Jonathan?
Yes.
Did you get the link I already sent on the chatting?
The attendance, is it?
Can you check the chatting? I already sent one YouTube link.
You sent another link.
Yes.
Okay.
So I'm not sure. Can you present for the whole group?
Share for the whole group, is it?
I'd like to present. Can you not only sharing? I'm asking to present the YouTube video for the whole page.
Yeah, I can open. Yeah.
Okay, please.
So I have to share my screen in there.
Yes, please.
Can you hear?
For me, it is clear, but I hope for the whole batch, it will be clear.
In this session, we're going to focus on percussion. Percussion is a technique discovered fairly recently by Leopold Oehlenbrugger. The story is that he was an innkeeper's son and he watched his father tapping on casks of wine to see how much wine was left. And from that, when he became a physician in the late 1700s, he discovered percussion. And everything we know about percussion, he described. He used an instrument that they laid on the chest and a tiny hammer. In fact, the present-day knee hammer has its genesis from that instrument. But we've found that we percuss much better when our finger is the plexometer and our other hand is the hammer. I know that there are many different ways to do this. I favor your putting your hand firmly against the patient's chest, not keeping the other fingers up, because I think it's harder to form a good seal. So push the fingers in, seated nicely in the intercostal spaces, and you're trying to aim for the middle of this phalanx. And it's important to keep your fingernails short in order to percuss successfully. Your wrist must be loose, and if you get all these things going, you will have a nice percussion stroke that will serve you very well. You're detecting a slight difference between left and right. And that is quite normal. That is the area of superficial cardiac dullness. And now we're going to go over the surface anatomy of the right side of the lung. Because if you think about it, there's no point in percussing and encountering an abnormality, dullness, say, if you don't know the normal anatomical boundaries and don't know if that's liver or lung. So I'm going to point out some of the surface markings and I'm going to draw them for you. If you were to put your finger in the suprasternal notch and bring your hand down, you would encounter the angle of Louis. It's a very important landmark. This is a suprasternal notch. Because lots of exciting things happen there. It's the level of the right atrium, the trachea bifurcates, the thoracic duct crosses over, the azotic vein joins, it's the lower border of T4. And for us, it's very helpful because the second rib joins right there, and therefore the space right below it is the second intercostal space. Now, in percussing on the right side, we must be conscious of the location of the major fissure, because the major fissure will divide things into the upper and lower lobes and the minor fissure. And I'm going to show you an easy way to do that without having to remember too many landmarks and so on. So let me demonstrate by having Jeff turn around for me a second. Now, this is the medial edge of Jeff's scapula with his arm at his side. So if you remember this, this is where his scapula is. I'm now going to have him put his hand on top of his head. And a really exciting thing happens is the moment he puts his hand on his head, the lower border of the scapula becomes a wonderful landmark for the major fissure. So this is the lower border of the scapula. And if I continue it up and then continue it through the side like so, it will eventually come meet the costal margin at about the sixth rib. right about there. And the median fissure, or the horizontal fissure, is found by drawing a line from the fourth rib. And if you follow that line, it eventually intersects with the other line. And as you can see, the axilla is the only place where you can see all three lobes of the lung, upper lobe, middle lobe, lower lobe. When you're examining the patient from the back, you're largely dealing with lower lobe with a little smidgen of upper lobe. And when you examine the patient from the front, you're mostly seeing upper lobe with a little silver of the middle lobe and a tiny silver of the lower lobe. In percussing the right side, it's terribly important, again, to know where the liver is, and especially to know the upper border of liver dullness, because the liver is here. It is dull when you percuss over it. You need to know the upper border so that you can say any dullness above that is fluid or consolidation. And the magic numbers to remember are 579. 579. The fifth rib in the midclavicular line. So here's the second rib, third, fourth, fifth. Right about there is the fifth rib in the midclavicular line. The seventh rib in the mid-axillary line. I'm going to turn Jeff a little bit and have you put your hand on your head. And I'm going to find my landmark again. Here's the seventh rib in the mid-axillary line. And the ninth rib, if I can turn you all the way, put your hand down. The ninth rib in the mid-scapular line, the ninth rib, which is about there. So remember the magic numbers 579, representing the midclavicular line, the mid-axillary line, the mid-scapular line. If you have dullness below that, that's normal, that's liver. If you have dullness above that, especially if it's considerably above that, it's quite abnormal. In percussing the left side of the chest, it's really quite different from the right side. On the right side, you have the solid organ of the liver to contrast its dullness with the resonance of the lung. On the left side, there's a slightly different situation. So on the left side, you have the heart. And as I mentioned before, you have a fist-sized area of dullness, which we call the area of superficial cardiac dullness. Everybody should be dull there. And if they're not, it suggests hyperinflated lung. The pulmonary second space, again, should always be resonant. And if it's not, it suggests perhaps an enlarged pulmonary artery. But the very interesting phenomenon here has to do with the gastric bubble that sits under the rib cage. Here is the lower margin of the rib cage, and the gastric bubble sits underneath there in an area called trop space, which I'm going to outline. Trop space, spelled T-R-A-U-B-E, is formed by dropping a perpendicular on the sixth rib in the midclavicular line. So here's the midclavicular line. Here's the second rib, third, fourth, fifth, sixth. So perpendicular from the sixth rib in the midclavicular line, and another perpendicular from the ninth rib in the anterior axillary line. And what you then get is an irregular quadrilateral representing the stomach bubble sitting quite high up. Don't forget, the diaphragm is quite a dome, even though the costal margin is here. And when we percuss the lung and go down this way, we go from resonance typically to tympani from that large solitary bubble. So listen to this. You hear how it became a much fuller, boxy sound, unlike this sound. And that represents the stomach bubble. It's a useful sign because if you have a pleural effusion on the left lung, it will seep into the costophrenic angle and it will obliterate trop space. Whereas if you have a consolidation of the lung will be consolidated, the lung sound will be flat, dull. And when you come here, trop space will be preserved because the lung boundary is over there. This represents the costophrenic recess. And so it's a useful sign in that situation.
The preceding program is copyrighted by the Board of Trustees of the Leland Stanford Junior University.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Jonathan. Can you share the PowerPoint again? Jonathan?
Yes, Prof. Yes, I'm sharing.
Okay, thank you. Okay, thank you. Can I take the control? Jonathan?
Yeah, I already gave you the control.
But still, I cannot.
Uni can see your mouse. But to control up, down is cannot.
But initially, I can take over and I can move up and down. But I'm not sure. Okay, you can keep your control. Never mind. So I hope this video demonstrate in clear way how to do percussion. Okay. So for more clarification, you have to do percussion. Okay, for the anterior aspect. In the midclavicular line, you have to do percussion for the supraclavicular notch, okay? Supraclavicular notch, and then you have to do percussion directly over the clavicle, and then you have to do percussion for the infraclavicular area, and then for the intercostal space. This is the anterior aspect percussion, and for the anterior aspect percussion, you should do light percussion through the midclavicular line. Okay. Then for percussion of the posterior aspect, you have to do heavy percussion, mainly through the scapular line. Three areas you have to percuss: supraspinatus area, and interscapular area, and infrascapular area. Please don't percuss over the scapula. Again, please don't percuss over the scapula. Okay, you have to do percussion above the scapula, enter between the scapula, and below the scapula. Okay, this is the posterior percussion. For the lateral aspect, you have to do percussion in the mid-axillary line, mainly in the mid-axillary line, for the intercostal spaces downwards. Okay, this is the the technique of percussion, and I hope you can watch the video many times to do standard percussion of the chest. Next slide, please. Jonathan? Yes. Those are the percussion points for the anterior aspect and for the posterior aspect. Okay. For the anterior aspect, again, you have to start off in the supraclavicular area, then going down. Okay. For the posterior aspect, please don't percuss over the scapula. Okay. Don't percuss over the scapula. Next slide. Next slide. So yes, this is the technique. This is the technique of the percussion. No, previous one, last one. Okay. So I'm going to. Jameson.
Yeah, which slide, doctor?
Okay, stop sharing. I'd like to share on my own.
Okay.
Thank you.
Doctor, I think
you're muted.
I'm sorry, Jonathan, can you share your PowerPoint? Because I cannot okay. share my PowerPoint. Okay, thank you. The previous one, please. The previous one. Jonathan? No, the next one.
Next one.
Yes, this one. Please, this is a standard technique of percussion, okay? You have to place your left hand, attach it firmly to the skin of the patient, okay? Then the middle finger with the right middle finger, okay? And the movement should be wrist movement, okay? The movement should be wrist movement, not elbow movement. So the movement should be wrist movement. So this is how to do percussion. Adhere your fingers to the patient's skin firmly, and you have to strike with the right middle finger on the left middle flanks of the left middle finger. Okay, this is the technique. And my recommendation is to practice percussion first on your chest to differentiate the resonant percussion note, and try to do percussion on your family member or your room mate.
Next one.
Okay, again, this is the percussion. You have to start the percussion from the supraclavicular area, okay? And then you have to do percussion, direct percussion. So percussion of the supraclavicular area should be over your finger, but on the clavicle, you have to do percussion directly over the clavicle. Then you have to start percussion in the infraclavicular area. Then you have to compare the right side to the left side, space by space. You have to compare the second intercostal space on the right side to the second of the left side, and you have to do the same on the percussion to compare the right and the left side. Next one, next slide. Okay, this diagram demonstrates the resonant percussion area. This is the lung area, and the dull area, this is the cardiac area, and the liver is also the dull area. This is the liver. So you have to differentiate between the resonant area over the lung and the dull percussion area over the heart and over the liver. And I think you can remember the rule of 5-6-9. This is the surface anatomy of the liver dullness. Okay, in the midclavicular line, the dullness of the liver starts on the fifth intercostal space, in the mid axillary, in the seventh intercostal space, and on the scapular area, it is over the ninth intercostal space. So try to differentiate between the resonant lung area and the dull cardiac and the hepatic area, and at the same time on the left side, the hyper-resonant area over the gastric fundus, or what we call TROPS area. TROPS area, this is the hyper-resonance over the gastric fundus or the gastric ear bubble. Next slide. Next slide. This is the posterior aspect. This is the posterior aspect, and this is the hyper-resonance or the resonance area of the lung. And again, don't percuss over the scapula. Don't percuss over. This is common mistake on OSCE station. Some students are going to percuss over the scapula, but as you can see, the resonant area is in between the scapula and below the scapula. Okay, don't forget to avoid percussion over the scapula. Next slide. Then the auscultation. Okay, auscultation, mostly you will use the diaphragm of the your stethoscope, apply the diaphragm firmly to the skin. Okay, on auscultation you have to comment on four items. You have to comment on the breath sound. Okay, is it normal or abnormal? You have to comment on the air entry. Is it equal on both sides? And you have to comment on any additional sounds, crackles or wheezes. And you have to comment on the tactile vocal resonance. So by auscultation, you have to present four items. You have to comment on the breath sound. Is it normal, vesicular or abnormal bronchial? And you have to comment on the air entry. Is it equal on both sides? And you have to comment on any additional sounds. And you have to comment on tactile vocal resonance. The same for palpation. Ask the patient to say 99 or 44 on auscultation. And you have to listen to the magnification of the sound by stethoscope. This is the tactile vocal resonance. On auscultation, you have to compare side by side, right to left, okay, and aspect by aspect, anterior and the lateral and the posterior. You have to compare zone by zone. We have upper zone, middle zone, lower zone, and space by space. Ask the patient to take deep and rapid breath with open mouth. Then you have to focus on the breath sounds. Try to pay attention to the expiration. Normally, the breath sound is like this. Long inspiration and short expiration. If you can appreciate short expiration, so that means the vesicular sound is normal vesicular sound, normal breath sound, normal vesicular sound. If the expiration is long expiration, that means it is abnormal bronchial sound. Okay, I hope you can put the stethoscope in your chest and try to listen to your breath sound and try to differentiate between the inspiration, which is long, and expiration, which is short. Okay, please, can you try to auscultate your breath sounds? I'm asking everyone to put your stethoscope and put the diaphragm on your chest and try to listen to your breath sound to differentiate the long inspiration and the short expirations. Please do like this for me. Jonathan.
Yes.
Can you auscultate? And I'd like everyone to auscultate his own breath sound or respiratory sounds?
Now.
Is it okay, or the stethoscope is not ready?
Some of us have stethoscopes, yeah.
So I hope the one who have stethoscope, please try to auscultate your chest sound and try to differentiate the inspiration and the expiration, and which one is long and which one is short. I hope this is very important practice to differentiate the normal breath sound, and you have to differentiate the long inspiration and the short expiration. Okay, I hope you can manage to do like this this afternoon. Those are the auscultation points for the anterior aspect and for the posterior aspect. And again, as I said right now, don't percuss over the scapula. The same for auscultation. Don't auscultate over the scapula. Don't auscultate over the scapula. And as you can see, the auscultation points is away from the scapula, away from the scapula. Okay, next slide. Again, those are the auscultation points for the anterior aspect and for the posterior aspect. You have to start off by the supra scapular area, then go downwards infraclavicular, supraclavicular, infraclavicular, then upper and the middle and the lower zone, and then the lateral aspect. Next one. Next slide. Okay, examination of the posterior chest, previous one, the last one. Go back, Jonathan. Posterior chest. Examination of the posterior chest is the most informative than the anterior chest. Most of the physical signs you can elicit on examination of the posterior chest more than the anterior chest. So try to focus. Don't forget to examine the posterior chest. You have to do the same inspection, palpation, percussion, and auscultation. For inspection, you have to comment on any scars, radiotherapy tattoos, any deformity, any abnormality in the chest shape, kyphosis, scoliosis. You have to comment on the respiratory movement or the breathing pattern. Okay, for palpation, you have to do assessment of the chest wall expansion, but no need, this is very important and a very common mistake, no need to assess just the chest wall expansion for the upper zone. For the posterior aspect, no need to assess the chest expansion for the upper zone. You have to assess the chest expansion only for the middle zone and the lower zone only. For the posterior aspect, no need to assess the upper zone chest wall expansion. Examine the lymph node. Don't forget to palpate the sacrum to rule out sacral edema if you are suspecting heart failure or Korbar Munnan. Do percussion for the upper and the middle and the lower zone in S shape, okay? Don't percuss over the scapula, and then auscultate the posterior aspect, okay? And you have to comment on the breath sound, okay? You have to comment on the air entry, you have to comment on the additional sound and tactile vocal resonance. Next slide. Okay, this is the chest examination or respiratory examination. Before going to end your examination, you have to examine the lower limb. You have to examine the lower limb to rule out any peripheral edema if you are suspecting heart failure or Korbar Munnan, any bruising cuff, any swelling or deep venous thrombosis, and any erythematous nodules, okay? If you are suspecting streptococcal infection or any connective tissue disease like sarcoidosis. So leg examination is very important component of examination of the pulmonary cases. Next one. Next slide. Okay, to close up your examination, you have to thank your patient. You have to be sure that the patient lies in comfortable position. You have to offer your help to redress your patient, and you have again to wash hands at the end of examination, and you have to tell the examiner to complete your examination. You have to perform pulse oximeter. You have to measure the peak expiratory flow test if your patient is asthmatic or if you need or requested to assess the respiratory function test. So the pulse oximeter is important complementary item of the pulmonary examination. Next one. Next slide. I think that's all for our topic today. I think there is only one more link for the respiratory examination. No, in the previous slide. I am like to ask everyone to have a look on the PowerPoint presentation, and have a look on the YouTube videos. There are three YouTube videos, one for Stanford and one for McLeod and one for Imperial College. I hope you can manage to see the whole YouTube video links, so you can get more clinical skills and more knowledge on examination of the respiratory system. I think that's all from my side, and I hope we can take some time to do, you know, free discussion and to answer some questions and to get some feedbacks from the whole batch. Thank you, Jonathan. Thank you.
Right. Welcome, doctor.
So I think this is the time for you, Jonathan, to moderate the discussion on our topic today. I think we can take some time, maybe 10 or 15 minutes, to discuss our topic and to take some questions. So no questions from the whole bench?
Doctor, I have a question.
Yes, please.
That 579 technique, is it only applicable for right lung, right side of lung? Or is it applicable for both, also applicable for left?
Okay, thanks for your smart questions. The rule of 9, 7, 5, 5, 7, 9, this is only for the right side. This is only to detect the liver dullness. So this is the upper border. This is the landmark or the surface anatomy of the landmark of the upper border of the liver on the right side only. in the mid-clavicular line, the dunnus is on the fifth intercostal space. In the mid-axillary line, seventh intercostal space. Scapular line, this is the ninth space. This is the liver or hepatic dullness on the right side only. Is it clear?
Yes, doctor. Thank you, doctor.
Okay, thanks for your questions. Any other questions? Okay. If you don't have questions, I think Jonathan, you can find the PowerPoint presentation in your WhatsApp. So please, you can forward to the whole page just to have a look on the PowerPoint presentation and on the YouTube videos. Please. Take your time to watch the YouTube video and to go through the PowerPoint presentation. And please let me know if you have any questions or any comments on the our topic today or in our video or PowerPoint presentation. From my side, I think that's all. So this is over to you, Jonathan.
Yes, doctor.
If nobody have any questions, so I'd like to thanks everyone for your attention and for your questions, and all the best, and stay safe, and thank you, and see you inshallah in the next presentation and online teaching class. Thanks everyone.
Thank you, doctor.
Okay, have a nice day.
Thank you.